Pastor.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'll just grab your attention for a moment, please. I just need to let you know that there's a white Kia Sportage that has left their lights on. So if you have a white Kia Sportage, registration DZH-11C, could you go turn your lights off so that you can get away at the end of today?
That's me.
Thank you, John.
No problem.
No, that's right.
Very smart child was meant to not let things like that happen.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'll just grab your attention for a moment. We're only a few minutes away from starting, and something that would be really helpful for us is if you could find your way into your seats, that would be fantastic. Thank you. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please stand for the procession? And a reminder that the choir will sing for us, and because of COVID, we are not allowed to sing. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. What a blessing. The rain makes the grass grow and it makes processions go quickly. It's a wonderful blessing to us all. Look, of course, the Metropolitan of our province here, Glendavies is here. That's fantastic. We have two previous Metropolitans as well. We have all of the provincial bishops of New South Wales and then a number of bishops who are with us from outside, the clergy of our diocese as well. And over in the hall, hello people in the hall, our representatives from our parishes right across our diocese, and we're so, so glad to have you here with us on this very special day. I'm going to greet you formally. Everything that you need is in your little service sheet that you were given as you came in. Can I reiterate that sadly because of the COVID things, we aren't going to be singing, and a few of the other little things in the service that we would normally do, we're going to do a little bit differently. One of those that I'll mention again later is we're going to remain seated for the readings, but when we get to that, I'll remind you of that fact. Well, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Now let us pray. Please sit or kneel. And we pray together quietly, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. In penitence and faith, let us confess, let us tell the truth about our sins to Almighty God. We pray together. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins. Strengthen you to do his will and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Well, I'd like to invite the Reverend Jum Naden to come and give an acknowledgement to country. Jum has done the beginning of his training with Rod, and so it's a great pleasure to have him to acknowledge our country here.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. As you've heard already, my name is Jum Naden, and I've been asked to do the acknowledgement today. This is an acknowledgement of country. I don't come from this area. My father's a Wiradjuri man, comes from Dubbo. My mother's from Central South Australia. She's an Arabunna woman. It's important that we do this this morning for our country. This is a part of the truth telling that desperately needs to happen here. Before this cathedral was here, before the city of Armidale was here, before the Anglican Church or this diocese even existed in this place, the Anawan people of this area lived here. And God was not ignorant of the Anawan, but rather he loved them. And he proved this by sending his son Jesus to die for their sins. On this joyous day, brother, and it is a great day to be celebrating with you, it's my hope and prayer that under your leadership, and not just your leadership, but the leadership of the other clergy in this diocese, that many, many people will come to know Jesus as Lord and Saviour, particularly Aboriginal people. So this morning, I'm going to use an acknowledgement that BCA, the Bush Church Aid, have come up with. This morning, we acknowledge the triune God, creator of heaven and earth, and his ownership over all things. We recognise that he gave stewardship of these lands upon which we meet to the First Nations people of this country. In his sovereignty, he has allowed other people groups to migrate to these shores. We acknowledge the cultures of our First Nations people and are thankful for the community that we share together now. This morning, we pay our respects to the Anawan, their elders, their leaders, both past and present, and those who are rising up to become leaders.
Let me again lead us in prayer, the collect. Almighty God, by your Son Jesus Christ, you gave many excellent gifts to your apostles and ordered them to feed your flock. Bless all bishops, the pastors of your church, that they may diligently preach your word and rightly instruct from it your people, and grant that your people may follow it faithfully, so that all may receive the crown of eternal glory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, please make yourselves comfortable for our three readings. Again, I would suggest to you that you remain seated for these readings against our normal custom, but it'll work out. So Sam, if you could come and read. Sam is Rod's son. He's reading the first reading. Terry Bowers is going to read the second, and Greg Harris, the BCA director, is going to read the third.
Our first reading is from Acts chapter 20, starting from verse 17 and going to verse 35. From Miletus, he sent a message to Ephesus, asking the elders of the church to meet him. When they came to him, he said to them, "You yourselves know how I lived among you the entire time from the first day that I set foot in Asia, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears, enduring the trials that came to me through the plots of the Jews. I did not shrink from doing anything helpful, proclaiming the message to you and teaching you publicly and from house to house, as I testified to both Jews and Greeks about repentance towards God and faith towards our Lord Jesus. And now, as a captive to the Spirit, I'm on my way to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and persecutions are waiting for me. But I do not count my life of any value to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the good news of God's grace. And now I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom will ever see my face again. Therefore, I declare to you this day that I am not responsible for the blood of any of you, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole purpose of God. Keep watch over yourselves and over all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God that he obtained with the blood of his own Son. I know that after I have gone, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. Some even from your own group will come, distorting the truth in order to entice the disciples to follow them. Therefore, be alert, remembering that for 3 years I did not cease, night or day, to warn everyone with tears. And now I commend you to God and to the message of his grace, a message that is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all who are sanctified. I coveted no one's silver or gold or clothing. You know for yourselves that I worked with my own hands to support myself and my companions. In all this, I have given you an example that by such work we must support the weak, remembering the words of the Lord Jesus. For he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 to 8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the threshold shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me! I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out." And then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I. Send me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The gospel reading is from Matthew chapter 28, beginning at verse 16. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I will ask us to stand. Let's join together with Christians throughout the ages, across the nations, and let us affirm together the faith of the Church. We say together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Well, please take a seat.
Let us pray. Our Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you that you've not left us in ignorance and darkness, but have given us the light of your word. And we pray now that by the power of your Holy Spirit, we may receive your word, believe it, and obey it, for Christ our Saviour's sake. Amen. Amen. The Gospel passage has been set as one of the passages in the Book of Common Prayer service for the consecration of a bishop, Matthew 28. Why? Why choose that one? I believe because it has a special ministry to the bishop's heart for the days ahead. And so as we look at that passage this morning and look at it in the light of Acts 20 and what it tells us, and also that magnificent moment in Isaiah, as we look at it this morning, we see three things. The first, the sight of glory. And then we turn our eyes to the sight of the bishop. And we turn once more to the sight of the Lord. So first of all, to the sight of glory. It was no accident, I think, that the Lord called them and met them at the mountain, where indeed God had revealed himself in times gone by at mountains like Mount Sinai. When they arrived there, knowing, having heard that the tomb was empty, that the Lord was not there, that in fulfillment of his promises, he was resurrected from the dead. When they arrived, they meet this Jesus. At the beginning of Matthew's Gospel, we're told that the name of Jesus means God with us, Emmanuel, God with us. When the temptations occur, chapter 4 of Matthew, when the temptations occur, the tempter offers Christ the kingdoms of this world, if only Christ would bow and worship him. And Christ chooses instead the path of the cross. And as the gospel finishes, we have in awful, awful detail the story of how Jesus is crucified, and as we know, crucified for the sins of the world, and in that way inherited what the devil had promised, the liar that he is. Now we have the empty tomb. We have the risen Christ. We have Christ on the mountain, And we see here not simply that it is the risen Christ, yes, of course, but there is a glory to this encounter, a glory. He is resplendent in glory. There is worship by those who meet him, but there's also doubt by some who meet him. Not so much the doubt of unbelief or scepticism, but the doubt of awe. How can this all be true is more what they are experiencing at the moment. It's Matthew's way of drawing together the past of what Christ has done, the present of the resurrected Lord, but also the future, for he is telling us that Christ is ascended, that Christ, when he ascended, takes his throne, takes his place at the right hand of the Father, that Christ now, in this present age, is the ruler of the present age, that he is in charge of all things, that Christ is seated in the heavenly places. It is his way of telling us that, yes, there is one God. You are baptized in the name of one God. And yet, there are three persons in this one God, all equally God, of course, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, ruling the world with Christ in particular as head of his church. It is a moment like the one that the prophet experienced in the temple when he sees the glory of God in the temple and falls, as you and I would too, on his face before the glory of God. And so when Jesus speaks, there are the famous alls, of course. All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go and make disciples of all nations, not simply the Jewish people, but rather tell them and teach them all my commands, and I will be with you always. He, this Lord Jesus, encountered in his glory on the mountain, he is the Lord of space and time, and he is filled with purpose. For in this age, he is bringing people, men and women of all nations, into his kingdom to be ruled over by him, those who belong to his church, baptized into the name of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, baptized into a living relationship, that is to say, with God himself. And Jesus, who rules all things, is making sure that his message will go to all the nations, and he will draw men and women from all nations that they may be saved. For the alternative is lostness. The alternative is hell itself. And he is saying, no, I have come that they may be saved. Go and tell the world, preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son, into the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them all I have commanded you, that they may be saved. These are, so to speak, his standing orders. Here is his last word to us. So why choose this passage at the consecration of a bishop? What is there that makes it particularly appropriate? Well, I said, first of all, we saw the sight of the risen Lord. But now we see the sight of the bishop. And here I speak personally and from knowing many bishops in all parts of the world. What do we see when we see a bishop? Well, you'll see many things. On an occasion like this, you will see the glory of dress, for example, and procession, and dignity and honour. But in the life of the bishop, never mind about that outward display, in the life of the bishop, there is, in my experience, great joy to see the work of God go forward, to see people come to know the Lord, to see people grow in their knowledge of the Lord, and many other things. There is satisfaction, there is energy, there is wisdom. All these things you may see and experience in the bishop and in the life of the bishop. But, as well, and I'm not sure if we carefully explained this to Rod, there are things that you can only experience, and even if we did explain it, you wouldn't know it until you do the job. There are relationships, as in every ministry and every human being, every human life, but there are relationships special to the experience of being a bishop, relationships that are often taxing relationships. You used to be a mate, a friend. You are now the bishop, and subtly but surely the relationship changes. And there are moments when you will have to say to mates, I am no longer your friend in that way, for I have an office to perform. Now you are the bishop, and it is different. You will be involved in a way that few are in other people's relationships. You will be told confidences, you will be privy to things that others are not. In marriage, in parish, sometimes with the state. And you will see sin at work, perhaps in ways that surprise and shock you. Yes, even though you've been a parish minister for a long time. And you will see pain and sickness as well. Yes, we all have these things in our life, one way or another. Yes, as a parish minister, you have these things. But when you are a bishop, these things come even more strongly, more powerfully. Relationships can be very taxing indeed. And then there are the responsibilities. You've had many responsibilities, Rod. I know that. But just you wait. I can only describe what my guess is. I don't know, but what my guess is what lays before you as chaotic, overwhelming. And being a rector, a chief minister, is only partially prepares you for the multitudinous tasks, the calls on your time and on your energy and on your wisdom. There is the whole business of travel, which is taxing. And one of the things we ought to pray for, our bishops, particularly our country bishops, is for safety in travel. There is the call for you to give advice when your own spiritual bank is quite empty and you hardly know how to advise yourself, let alone someone else. There are conferences to attend and to organise. There are other entities in the diocese which call upon you at time to time, and particularly not when things are going well, but when things are not going well and you are summoned in. And there is the constant awareness. True, you have this already, but there is a special constant awareness, I believe, that the decisions you can make can impact many lives. I always say that there's about 20 people that I know of who are very, very angry with me as a result of me being Archbishop of Sydney within the Diocese of Sydney, let alone elsewhere, and because of decisions I've made about their lives. And 10 of them are right. I made a bad decision. And it's impacted their lives. And I can only say I'm sorry. But you have to make decisions. You have to take that responsibility. You have to be aware that your decisions carry often large implications. There's relationships and there's responsibilities, and there's only one other thing that I'm going to mention. There's aloneness. I haven't said loneliness, that's true, but it's aloneness. Of course, you're never alone. That's one of the problems. You wake up in the morning and the email bank is full, and 3/4 of them are nothing, but 1/4 of them demand careful attention. You are never alone, but you're always alone. There will be those who advise you. There will be those whose counsel you seek. Of course there will. Thank God for that. But there are also confidential decisions that only you can make. there are moments when you have to decide, and you have to decide on grounds that no one else knows about. It's your decision. There are unpopular courses of action that need to be taken. There will be criticism, and there will be gossip. And these things will surround you and make you feel alone. Just this last week, I received a letter from a bishop who is many miles away from here, many kilometres away from here. And he's in charge of a diocese. And it's in meltdown. Not his fault, but all sorts of things are going on within the diocese. The long email finished, I was just sort of, he told me without any sense of feeling sorry for himself. Not at all. That's not how he wrote to me. But he finished with these words, "This is a lonely task." And I knew what he meant. You're never alone, but it is lonely, as is all leadership of this sort. Well, the sight of Christ on the mountain, the sight of the bishop, remember the joy, the wonders, the opportunities, the very good things, but bear in mind too these other things I've mentioned. And so finally coming back now to the sight of the Lord. If your eyes are fixed on Jesus, if your eyes are fixed on Jesus, then what does he say to you? He says, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." All authority in heaven and earth does not reside in you, although people will want to make you feel that it does, but it doesn't. For all authority in heaven and earth belongs to the Lord. The letter I just referred to began with these words. "I just wanted you to know that the Lord continues to sustain us through the storm, and we thank God regularly for the answered prayers of friends who remember us." That's how he began the letter, because he knows through personal experience that the Lord Jesus is the Lord of all things, and that our prayers will be answered, and that the Lord will keep us in the midst of the storm. The Lord is sovereign. He is sovereign over time. Our time is his, not ours. He sustains us in chaos, and he calms the wind as he did with his disciples on the sea. You may trust him always. He is the Lord of history, and he is the Lord of trials and troubles. You will need to be disciplined, of course, in order to get through the burdens. But you also, because you know the Lord is in charge of all things, you'll be willing to have time for people who are sent into your life by the Lord. The knock on the door, metaphorically, more likely to be a phone call. That moment when someone comes, when you're busy, but you know that you must put your busyness to one side and listen. Because the Lord is in charge of time, even your time. We're reminded that God gives us sleep in order to tell us that he's in charge, not us. It's his work we do. And your business is not to be in charge of everything because you are the bishop, but to simply make it your aim to please him because he is the Lord. All authority given to him. Second, as we think of the sight of the Lord here, what the Lord has given us here and what the service gives us is a key focus. Yes, it's chaos. Yes, there are many responsibilities, many people calling upon your time. But from time to time, Rod, ask yourself, What matters above all? What is the focus? What is the one thing that matters above all things? And the Lord Jesus said and says to us, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. For if the promotion of the gospel into all the world is not at the center of our hearts, we will be swamped by all the chaos. We will find ourselves doing a million different things, but never actually progressing the standing orders, never progressing what the Lord has said we are to do above all else. If we remember that is our goal, to please the Lord by preaching his word, by making disciples, and by sustaining disciples through his word, for that is the way in which disciples are won and disciples sustained, through his word, then you may be a wonderfully busy bishop, but you won't be a godly bishop. And furthermore, please remember, everything I have commanded you, it is not as though you make up the program. It is not as though you invent the message. It's not as though you can suddenly say, oh yes, look, this is the better way of growing disciples. I've invented a better way of doing it. It's this, that, or the other. No. You do it through his word. If the bishop is not loyal to the word of God, then don't be a bishop. We must have loyalty to the word in a time in our national life where the word of God is being put aside, neglected, ignored, and even vilified. You have to make the stand, as all those called to ministry must, and all Christians must. But you in your role of leadership must say, I take my stand on the word of God. For that is the way in which disciples are made and disciples sustained, and that's my business. Now, as bishop, you have a special responsibility, for you ordain others. And that responsibility is a responsibility for selection, training, deployment, and sustaining ministers of the gospel. You've not had that responsibility before, but now you do. And it always has to be done with Matthew 28 in mind, that you are praying for, selecting, training, ordaining, deploying, sustaining ministers of the gospel who will preach the gospel and be faithful to the word of God. That's a big responsibility. I would say it's the best, it's the biggest. And then finally, what the passage gives us, authority in heaven and earth, yes, the Lord is in charge. Focus in our responsibilities, now finally assurance in aloneness. I've painted a picture of being lonely and so forth and so on. I hope he's going to stand up in a minute and say he's still going to do this. So let's say this to him, for what the passage reminds us of here. There's assurance in his aloneness. Look at the last verse. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. David Livingstone, the great explorer, used to say, people say, how can you do these things? Such danger in such places. He said, the Lord has said, I am with you always, and I trust the word of a gentleman, is what he said. And so we may. I've used the word assurance because we need, in fact, crucial to the Christian life in our generation is assurance. It begins with a recognition of our own sinfulness and guilt. We are not good people. We are people who have disobeyed the Lord, and we have no call upon salvation whatsoever. We cannot crawl our way to heaven. The only righteousness you can lay claim to is the righteous robe of the Lord Jesus Christ, which he throws over his people, and we become righteous through his death for us on the cross. Your only hope in life and in death is the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. You will make many mistakes. You have many failings. We know that. You're human. But you'll be clothed in the righteousness of Christ. And with all your mistakes and the guilt you may feel, you'll know that he has taken your burden for you on the cross. And he sustains you by his constant presence. I am with you always. You will see providences. You will see answers to prayer. You will see signs of the Lord's being with you as you walk along the way. You'll know that he is there. You'll know it because his word tells you it's true. And you'll know it because you'll experience it. But whether you experience it or not, it's true because Christ died for you on the cross. And Rod, you're a sinner like the rest of us. Your only hope is Jesus. If that's true, then you'll never be alone. And so to Rod and to Jenny, I say this. There's a special word for you for the Lord Jesus. He said this. You can have this as your text. Come to me, all who weary and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. Take my yoke upon you. And learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find me rest for your souls. And lo, I am with you always, to the end of the age. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we pray that we may trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, that we may experience that assurance of knowing that guilty and sinful though we are, yet nonetheless, he died for us. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that you would help us all of us, to be faithful to your word and to stand for the Lord Jesus Christ in our generation, to make disciples and to grow disciples, always trusting in the Lord Jesus who has all power in heaven and earth. And we pray for these mercies, Heavenly Father, sinful though we are, in the great name of Jesus. Amen.
Could you bring that chair out?
Archbishop Glenn, we present to you this godly and learned man, Rodney James Chiswell, to be ordained and consecrated bishop.
I invite the provincial registrar to read out the authority for the consecration.
Whereas A, in accordance with the provisions of the Governance of the Diocese Ordinance 2016-2019 of the Diocese of Armidale, the Reverend Rodney James Chiswell, Vicar of Tamworth South in the Diocese of Armidale, is a person who is eligible for appointment as Diocesan Bishop in the Diocese of Armidale within the Anglican Church of Australia. B, upon such nomination, the said name was elected by the Synod in accordance with the said ordinance. C, I have communicated this information to the bishops of the diocese within the province of New South Wales, and they have notified me that they are satisfied that the Reverend Rodney James Chiswell is canonically fit to become the diocesan bishop in accordance with sections 2 and 3 of the Provincial Ordinance for the Confirmation of Bishops' Elections 1965. Now, therefore, I, Glenn Naunton Davies, Archbishop of Sydney and Metropolitan of the Province of New South Wales, certify the confirmation of the election of the said Rodney James Chiswell to be Diocesan Bishop of Armidale, such appointment being subject to the ordinances and rules of the Anglican Church of Australia in the Diocese of Armidale. Witnessed under the seal of the Archbishop of Sydney, which in this behalf is used this 12th day of December 2020 in the 19th year of my consecration. Signed, G.N. Davies, Archbishop of Sydney and Metropolitan.
The Anglican Church of Australia, being an apostolic church, receives and retains the Catholic faith, which is grounded in Holy Scripture and expressed in the creeds, and within its own history in the 39 articles, in the Book of Common Prayer, and in the ordering of bishops, priests, and deacons. In accordance with the canons of this church, I now require you to make your declaration and assent to this faith.
I, Rodney James Chiswell, firmly and sincerely believe the Catholic faith, and I give my assent to the doctrine of the Anglican Church of Australia as expressed in the Book of Common Prayer and the ordering of bishops, priests and deacons, and the Articles of Religion as acknowledged in Section 4 of the Constitution. And I believe that doctrine to be agreeable to the Word of God. I declare my assent to the fundamental declarations of the Anglican Church of Australia as set out in Sections 1, 2 and 3 of the Constitution. In public prayer and administration of the sacraments, I will use the form prescribed in the Book of Common Prayer or a form authorised by lawful authority and none other.
Rodney, you have been chosen to serve as a bishop in the Church of God and to serve as the Bishop of Armidale in the Anglican Church of Australia. In accordance with the law of our church, I now require you to declare your assent to the constitution and canons of this church and to take the oath of canonical obedience.
I, Rodney James Chiswell, do solemnly and sincerely declare my assent to be bound by the constitution of the Anglican Church of Australia and the constitution of the province of New South Wales and of this diocese, and by the canons, statutes, ordinances, and rules, however described from time to time, of the Synod of this diocese and of the General Synod and of the Provincial Synod, which have force in this diocese. I, Rodney James Chiswell, do swear that I will pay true canonical obedience to the Most Reverend Dr. Glenn Davies, Metropolitan of New South Wales, and all the successors in that office, in all things lawful and honest. So God help me.
Brothers and sisters, it is written in the Gospel of St. Luke that our Saviour Christ spent the whole night in prayer before he chose and sent out his 12 apostles. It is written also in the Acts of the Apostles that the disciples who were at Antioch fasted and prayed before they laid hands on Paul and Barnabas and sent them out. Let us, therefore, following the examples of our Saviour and his apostles, commit ourselves to prayer before we admit and send out this person, Rodney, presented to us to the work to which we trust the Holy Spirit has called him.
I'd ask you now to take a few moments of silent prayer to pray for Rod and also for our diocese. I'm going to lead us now in the Litany for Ministry. You'll see there are responses as we go. God the Father, have mercy on us. God the Son, have mercy on us. God the Holy Spirit,
have mercy on us. Holy Trinity, one God, have mercy on us. We humbly pray that you will hear us, good Lord. Grant to your people the forgiveness of sins, growth in grace, and the fruit of the Spirit. Lord, hear our prayer. Send your peace to the world which you have reconciled to yourself by the ministry of your Son, Jesus. Heal the divisions of your church, that all may be one, so that the world may believe. Lord, hear our prayer. Lead the members of your church in their vocation and ministry, that they may serve you in true and godly living. Lord, hear our prayer. Raise up faithful and able ministers for your church, that the gospel may be known to all people. Lord, hear our prayer. Fill them with compassion, clothe them with humility, and move them to care for all your people. Lord, hear our prayer. Inspire all bishops, priests, and deacons with your love, that they with all your people may hunger for your truth. Lord, hear our prayer. Sustain by the indwelling of your Holy Spirit all who are called to the ordained ministries of your church, and encourage them to persevere to the end. Lord, hear our prayer. Gather us with all your saints into your eternal kingdom. Lord, hear our prayer. Eternal God and Father, you have promised to hear those who pray in the name of your Son. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may surely obtain according to your will, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, giver of all that is good, by your Holy Spirit, you have appointed various orders of ministers in your church. Bless your servant Rodney, now called to the work and ministry of a bishop. So fill him with the truth of your doctrine and clothe him with holiness of life, that he may faithfully minister in this office to the glory of your name and the benefit of your church. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated.
My brother, the Holy Scripture and the ancient canons command that we should not be hasty in laying on of hands and admitting anyone in government to the Church of God. Therefore, before I admit you to this ministry, I must examine you in certain matters so that the congregation present may hear how you are determined to act in the Church of God. Are you convinced that you are truly called to this office according to the will of our Lord Jesus Christ and the order of the Anglican Church in Australia?
I am.
Are you convinced that the Holy Scriptures contain all doctrine required of necessity for eternal salvation through faith in Jesus Christ? And will you instruct the people committed to your care from the Scriptures and teach nothing as required of necessity for salvation except what you are convinced may be proved by the Scriptures?
I am convinced and will do so by God's grace.
Will you then study the Scriptures and pray for a true understanding of them so that you may be able to teach and exhort with sound doctrine and be able to withstand and convince those who speak against them?
I will do so by the help of God.
Are you ready to drive away all false and strange doctrine which is contrary to God's word, and privately and publicly to call upon and encourage others to do likewise?
I am, the Lord being my helper.
Will you forsake ungodliness and worldliness and live moderately, righteously, and in a godly manner, so that by your example and good works you may show forth the love of God to others?
I will, the Lord being my helper.
Will you maintain and promote, as much as lies in your power, quietness, peace, and love among all people? And will you correct and discipline
according to the authority you have by God's word, the disorderly and disobedient, and those guilty of offence within your jurisdiction.
I will, by the help of God.
Will you be faithful in ordaining, commissioning, and laying hands upon others?
I will, by the help of God.
Will you be gentle and merciful for Christ's sake to the poor and needy and all strangers who need your help?
I will, by God's help.
Almighty God, who has given you the will to do all these things, grant you the strength and power to perform them, that he may finish the work he has begun in you through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
We are going to listen to a song. Sadly, we won't be able to sing it, as we've said before. That's a particular sadness for Rod. As you know, he's got a very, very great love for music. But we will sit and listen. And the words of this song are incredible indeed. They're wonderful, wonderful truths. So please make yourselves comfortable.
Does
Let us pray. Almighty God and Heavenly Father, by your infinite love and goodness, you have given us your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer and the author of eternal life. After he had ascended into heaven, he poured down his gifts abundantly on men, making some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to the building up of his church. Grant, O Lord, we beg you, to this your son, your servant Rodney, grace that he may always be ready to proclaim the good news of salvation and reconciliation. May he be a wise and faithful steward of your mysteries, so that at the last he may be received into eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen. Receive the Holy Spirit for the office and work of a bishop in the Church of God, now committed to you by the laying on of our hands. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Remember to stir up the grace of God which was given you by the laying on of our hands. For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Give your attention to reading, exhortation, and teaching. Think upon the things contained in this book. Practice them, that what you learn may be evident to all people. Apply these things to yourself. Teach them and practice them diligently, for in so doing, you will save yourself and those who hear you. Be to the flock of Christ a shepherd and not a wolf. Feed them, devour them not. Support the weak, heal the sick, bind up the broken, restore the outcast, seek the lost. Be merciful without being remiss. Administer discipline with mercy. When the chief shepherd appears, may you receive the never fading crown of glory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Most merciful Father, we beg you to send your heavenly blessing upon this your servant Rod. So clothe him with your Holy Spirit that faithfully fulfilling his ministry, he may at the last receive the crown of righteousness from him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, I present to you Rodney Chiswell, Bishop in the Church of God.
Our service today has two parts, the consecration of a bishop, which we've just been a part of, and now the installation of a bishop, and Rod will be placed in his cathedral to take his seat. You can keep following along in your service outlines. Bishop Rodney, I install you in the cathedral of this Cathedral Church of St. Peter. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, the Lord bless you and give you peace. Amen.
I, Brian, as the Vicar General of the Diocese of Armidale, induct you, Rodney James Chiswell, in the possession of the Bishopric of the Diocese of Armidale, with its duties and responsibilities of service, and I place in your hand this diocesan pastoral staff. Long may you hold it to tend the flock of Christ with love and care. May Christ, the Good Shepherd, be with you and bless you at all time and in all things. Amen.
I invite all the bishops in the province of New South Wales to stand, even if you're retired. And without a stipend. I, Glenn, Metropolitan of New South Wales, on behalf of the bishops of this province, to recognise you as the Bishop of the Diocese of Armidale and welcome and greet you as our brother bishop, praying God's blessing on your work in this diocese and in our province.
Thank you.
My brothers and sisters of the clergy, I present to you Rodney, our bishop. And the clergy say together,
we the clergy of this office do recognize you as our bishop. We pledge to you our loyalty and prayers and our diligence in the task that is both yours and ours.
Thank you. Now the laity. Beloved in God, I present to you Rodney, our bishop. And together you say that we, the people of this diocese, do recognize you as our bishop. We pledge you our loyalty and prayers and our diligence in the task of the bishop.
I thank you all for your greetings and assure you of my prayers for you, for all who work with you and all whom you represent.
You can return to your cathedral, Bishop.
Excellent.
We are the body of Christ. His Spirit is with us. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
You might, in COVID safety, just greet the person next to you with the peace of the Lord. Peace be with you. Brother Bishop, peace be with you. Vicar General, no longer administrator. Thanks, Brian. Lift up your hearts, lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks, and it is indeed right and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Lord, Holy Father, Mighty Creator, and eternal God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with the whole company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of all your glory. Glory to you, O Lord Most High. We do not presume to come to your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. All glory to you, our Heavenly Father, for in your tender mercy you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world, and who instituted in his holy gospel, commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, merciful Father, and grant that we who receive these gifts of your creation, this bread and this wine, according to your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, and may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who on the night he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. Eat this. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given you thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Amen. This is a COVID communion, so you'll have, I believe, an individual serving of a cup and bread. If you take the first layer off, you'll find your access to the wafer that is there. We will eat together, and then after we've done that, the second layer will give you access to the cup. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you. Preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, preserve your body and soul into everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. As our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are confident to say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Lord and Heavenly Father, we, your servants, entirely desire your fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and to grant that by the merits and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and your whole church may receive forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present to you, O Lord, ourselves and our souls and bodies to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice, humbly beseeching you that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be fulfilled with your grace and heavenly benediction. And although we are unworthy, through our many sins, to offer you any sacrifice, yet we pray that you will accept this, the duty and service we owe, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offences. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, in whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, Father Almighty, now and forever. Amen. I'll now invite the registrar to give us some housekeeping arrangements with regard to what takes place after the service.
After the service, we've got some refreshments and a welcome for Rodney as well, down at the X-Services Club, which is just down the hill. You'll find on the back of your program instructions as to how to walk there. I suspect you'll probably want to drive, which is good because there's a car park, especially for the club, round the back of the club. And at the moment, there's building work at the front entrance to the club, so the only entrance is from the rear. So drive down there, park in the car park, come in the back door. They're expecting us there from 12, so we've still got a little time. Archbishop might want to speak a little further.
We're going to conclude the service slightly differently from what you would ordinarily expect. We would normally have the bishops and clergy recess and then down and have photographs outside the west door. Because of the inclement weather, welcome inclement weather, we're going to have the photographs inside the cathedral. So I'll give directions for that. So with that in mind, I'm going to ask the musicians and singers to sing our final song, and after that I'll pronounce the benediction, and then the bishops will have their photographs in the chancel here, and then I'll invite the clergy to come and have the photographs with their bishop, and the rest of the congregation, you can go and get first drinks at the reception. Thank you, musicians.
Stone, this solid ground, firm through the visa's drought and storm.
forgot to mention that I invited Bishop Rod and myself to be part of the singers, since we're 5 metres from the congregation and 1.5 metres separate, just in case there's a lawyer in the house. God, give you grace to follow the apostles, Peter and Paul, and all the saints in faith and hope and love. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. That go in peace was for the laity, basically. So I now invite the bishops to assemble in the chancel.